This is my studio. This is where I am all day. And this is where I did Don't Take the Money. So I'm going to take you through it. So I had the thought in my head about this line, Don't Take the Money, and writing about your past and then this fight you have in your relationship and sort of the euphoria of hitting rock bottom with someone else and then choosing to be together. So I had that. I knew that. And I knew that was very sad. And also there was like a bigness to it because it was like a lot of honesty. So I wanted it to be something that could exist in this like big celebration of a song, but also retain all the sadness. So I started messing around. And I had this idea, don't take the money. Don't take the money, don't take the money. Like I didn't know what the melody was, but I knew it was like, you know, kind of over and over. So this is where I was at. I was at this kind of just like driving Radio Gaga feeling drum beat. And I remember just like playing with that for a really long time, trying to find this perfect like 16th note pattern. And it feels cool. Still feels like a drum machine and a tape machine. And so I remember I went outside right up to the place and I just turned my phone on and I just started recording the street. But then I put it on top of the beat. Which is actually how the song starts with a second of that noise. And it kind of feels alive. Like there's like, feels like the neighborhood. And then it kind of turned into. This is that actual bass. So I kind of took it and I made it, you know, almost sound more like a Moog, which then led me to just want to put like a very digital, not digital, analog, but like synth element on top of it. Like. So I'm fucking around with all that and I ended up playing these two things on top of each other, which really became the backbone of the song, of the sticky bass with the drum. And so the live bass with the synth bass, this is what you get together. And that to me became, well, I mean, it's the rhythm section, but it became like what was exciting about the song. So I was like, all right, you have this limb drum. It sounds like a limb drum, but it doesn't sound like a limb drum because it's all fucked out going through there. You have this bass which sounds like this like super compressed Paul McCartney bass, but then it's doubled with a distorted mini Moog, and so then it was really starting to congeal, like there's a sound here, and it started to get tough, which was nice. So then I started really thinking, like, I want this thing to be tough and I want this thing to be big and brooding, but what I'm talking about is also really intensely sad. You know, since all this stuff is analog, you can't literally recreate it, but I remember sitting here just messing around. Messing around in that general space, which ended up becoming this. And it moves around. You can see it in the waveform, but it just sort of dances across the thing, and that lives behind so much of the song, and that's the sweetness of the song, you know, because you can't have. You know, this is exciting, but it's not sweet. You put that arp on top, it starts to get very pretty. And at that point, you start really having the backbone of the chorus. And as soon as it goes to the pre, so there's these moments where all the reverb goes away. So it's so wet and lush. Understand. Well, I understand. And it was totally dry. Will we fight? Stay up late in my dreams. And it's like I'm yelling right in your face. So that's what I had at that point. And then I was thinking to myself, what sounds frantic? There's nothing frantic going on. You know, the beat keeps going. And then I actually literally keep these bells like hanging around here. And I remember like kind of like tapping on them, and there's two mics right up there. You see that? So there's one on both sides. So there's a stereo pair in here, so I can just sort of like sit here and just like record things. And this was the loop that came out of it. It's very wide. That's the thing about these mics, is like it sounds like a room. So I liked that, and then I was like kind of thinking about Bernie Worrell talking heads type sounds. That kind of thing, and I was like, if I can use that percussively, it might get more exciting. And it kind of started doing. It's a terrible place. This is what it actually sounds like on the album. This was the part. Like these like percussive hits, and that da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I remember playing it on there, and then I ended up mirroring it. Now we're stuck in the storm we were born to ignore, and all I got is a chance to just say, the guitar, which is really interesting because I wanted to find a space where there could be live guitar as much on this thing as possible. And it was. The way that guitar ended up becoming existing on the record was just that riff. And what I just ran you through in a couple minutes was actually months and months of, you know, driving myself crazy in this room. Because it starts, you know, you have the song and you think of the song. And you write a song and it's lyrics and melody. And then, I mean, that's lightning in a bottle when you can even get that far. I don't write that many songs. You know, when I make an album, I just write those songs. There's not a whole list of other songs that didn't make it. It's just those. But then when you start to put it together and, you know, this might look like a bunch of stuff, but these are just a few things that I really know how to use to, you know, because you're just trying to get the sound in your head out. So I know how to use them to achieve some of those sounds. You spend so many nights in here, and you miss birthdays and things like that because you're just trying to find out what it's supposed to sound like. You're trying to just wait till you have that gut feeling.